بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله. All praises are due to Allah, the creator, the cherisher, and the sustainer of this universe. And may his peace and blessings be upon his noble prophet Muhammad and his companions and descendants and followers, dear respected brothers and sisters. جزاكم الله خيراً for coming. As you heard, this is the last session of our 8-week workshop, the spiritual purification. And today's session is titled Sincerity and True Humbleness. But before starting with the today's topic, I would like to hear from you. What did you do during the past week? Who did the homework regarding the reciting the Quran with reflection upon the verses that address the names of Allah, Al-Qayyum, the ever-watchful, and Al-Mun'im, the giver, and Al-Ghani, the self-sufficient. Who did that last week? I want to see your hands. No, don't tell me none. One, two. Come on. By the way, yani, when I ask who did it, you have to tell me if you did it. Yani here, this cannot be secretly from me. I am now, okay, thank you. For some people, look, they are shy. Taib, jazakallah khair. Taib, what about the Sawm? We said we will fast for 2 days. Okay, were you able to do it secretly the whole day? Huh? Okay, good, but secretly? No one knew, huh? Were you able to do that? MashaAllah, huh? You couldn't? Huh? But who started and then he couldn't keep it secret? Okay. Your wife came to know. Well, it's hard sometimes with the spouse. Yani, but at least your colleagues and your friends didn't know that day. This is very important. Spouse, very hard to keep it secret from her. Okay, good. But what about Qiyam al-Layl? Who prayed, stood the night in adoration for Allah for some time? Good. Secretly, no one knew. Next day, no one knew, huh? Okay, good. Who else? Tayyib, mashallah. Tayyib. Let's start. Guys, I need to tell you that the homework of the spiritual purification is as important as the homework of the heart purification, the tarbiyah imani. But looks like because we don't yani make people send daily emails like the Tarbiyah Imaniyah, people don't really do the homework. Maybe inshallah we will look at that inshallah when we do the spiritual purification in other cities. We will make people send emails inshallah. Today's topic is about sincerity and true humbleness, which is actually the main theme of the workshop. So today's talk is mainly concluding the whole workshop. We're concluding or reviewing together what we did before. Does any one of you doubt that he needs the forgiveness of Allah? Do you think you don't need it? We all know that we all need the forgiveness of Allah. Does any one of you doubt that he needs guidance from Allah? We all know that. We know we all need the guidance of Allah. Does any one of you doubt that he needs taqwa, God-fearing? We all need it. Huh? What? Why then, if we all of us know that we need them, why do we get offended when someone tells us, may Allah forgive you? Ittaqillah, fear Allah. Why do you get offended then? If you really know that you need it. Why do you get offended when someone says, may Allah guide you? Do you? The issue is, you have to ask yourself, when someone tells you this, even I know that many people say it with an attitude, and they say it in a way because they want to insult you or offend you. But when you hear someone telling you, may Allah guide you, do you feel offended or deep in your heart you feel like, Ameen, Ya Rab. Oh Allah, listen to him. Accept from him this da'wah. This is the issue. If you feel offended when someone tells you that, even if you say it with an attitude, then you have a problem. Do we tell Allah, Hadratak? Do we tell Allah, Sir? We say, Oh Allah. We don't say, Sir. We don't say, Hadratak. Maybe except Sisi. But we don't say that. Why do we ask people to say it to us? Why are we offended when we are called, Sir? Especially when he's an employee who works for you, or someone who works for you, and you're expecting him to give you a lot of respect. Then you have a problem. You have an ego problem. And this is the problem. Ego destroys people. So this is one issue that we need to talk about today, inshallah. The other issue is, we talked a lot also during this workshop about what we really need from Allah, which is forgiveness. The forgiveness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Prophet Muhammad himself and told him, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ وَيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَيَهْدِيَكَ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. Truly, we have opened up a path to clear triumph for you, Prophet, so that God may forgive you your past and future sins, complete His grace upon you, guide you to a straight path. So Allah informed the Prophet ﷺ that He forgave his sins, past and future sins. What if you receive a message like that from Allah? Imagine that you received a message from Allah that Allah forgave you all your sins, past and even future sins. What do you think you will do? I believe you will say, good, let me take a break. Let's take the kids to Greece then. Or run to Disneyland. Because khalas, Allah forgave me my sins. But how did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam face or meet, what was the impact of Allah's forgiveness on him? More acts of worship. More asking forgiveness. More sawm. More qiyam al-layl. More. And Lady Aisha was, actually she wondered, why are you doing this? Allah forgave you all your sins, past and future sins. He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا? Can't I be a grateful servant? Same with Lady Maryam. Lady Maryam, the Malaika, spoke to her and informed her. وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. The angel said to Mary, Mary, God has chosen you and purified you and chosen you above all the women of the world. So, take a break? No. The malaika continued, Ya Maryam, uqnuti li rabbiki, wasjudi warka'i ma'a raki'in. O Mary, be devout to your Lord. Prostrate yourself in worship. Bow down with those who pray. She was forgiven and chosen and purified. Because of that, you have to seek forgiveness more. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. So what we need is forgiveness. We spoke last time that what we need from Allah is His forgiveness. And we will not be forgiven for our good deeds. Our good deeds are not enough to allow us to paradise. It just makes us more subject to receive the mercy of Allah. That's it. It's all about the mercy of Allah. So you're subjecting yourself to the mercy of Allah by doing the good deeds. But the good deeds themselves are not enough. And will not be enough. But we do it because we seek the mercy of Allah. Try to find the similarities between these verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 9, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً مغفرة وأجر عظيم. God has promised forgiveness and a rich reward to those who have faith and do good works. So those who have faith and do good work are promised what? Forgiveness and a rich reward. Verse number 11 in Surah Hud. إلا الذين صبروا وعملوا الصالحات أولئك لهم مغفرة وأجر كبير. Those who are steadfast and do good deeds, they will have forgiveness and a great reward. So they will have forgiveness and a great reward. Always you find forgiveness coming first. Always forgiveness come first. الذين كفروا. This ayah is amazing. الذين كفروا لهم عذاب شديد والذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم مغفرة وأجر كبير. Those who disbelieve will be punished severely. And those who believe and do good deeds, you are expecting Allah to say what? In contrast with punishment, to say they will have paradise, gardens, heavens. You find Allah saying will be forgiven and richly rewarded. So before the reward, Allah always mentions the forgiveness. Without the forgiveness, no reward is coming. Forgiveness is what we really seek. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَإِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ وَالْخَاشِعِينَ وَالْخَاشِعَاتِ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقِينَ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقَاتِ وَالصَّائِمِينَ وَالصَّائِمَاتِ وَالْحَافِظِينَ فُرُوجَهُمْ وَالْحَافِظَاتِ وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ أُولَئِكَ والذكر أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. All those received what? مغفرة وأجر عظيم. Forgiveness. And the verse says in Surah Al-Ahzab, for men and women who are devoted to God, believing men and women, obedient men and women, truthful men and women, steadfast men and women, charitable men and women, fasting men and women, chaste men and women who remember God often, God has prepared for them what? Forgiveness and a rich reward. Forgiveness always comes first. This is what we seek. And I have a lot of examples. A lot of examples. حمكم الله. إن الذين يخشون ربهم بالغيب لهم مغفرة وأجر كبير. But there is forgiveness and a great reward for those who fear their Lord though they cannot see him. So the reward of the good work is forgiveness and paradise and reward. Forgiveness comes first. And the Quran emphasized a lot on this. Again, a verse in Surah Al-Baqarah emphasizes on this so much. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ وَالْعَذَابَ بِالْمَغْفِرَةِ فَمَا أَصْبَرَهُمْ عَلَى النَّارِ. These are the ones who exchange guidance for error. You see, guidance and error, opposite to each other, right? And exchange forgiveness for torment. He didn't say paradise for torment. He said forgiveness for torment. So the Quran is putting the forgiveness on a side, on the other side, torment. He doesn't say the paradise and torment. SubhanAllah. Forgiveness is what we really seek. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 218, but those who have believed, migrated, and striven and striven for God's cause, it is they who can look forward to God's mercy. It is they who can look forward to, here you're expecting God's generosity. But you say God's mercy. They migrated and they practiced jihad and they practiced a lot of very, very hard work. But they can receive God's mercy. God is most forgiving and merciful. Because of God's mercy, we can be allowed to paradise. But it's about God's mercy. I told you a lot of examples. Can't mention them all. The Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also emphasized on this. The Prophet said, رَغِمَ أَنْفْ مَنْ أَدْرَكَ رَمَضَانَ وَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. The loser is he who reaches Ramadan and is not forgiven his sins. Didn't say, and goes without reward. He said, if you reach Ramadan and you don't get forgiven, you lost. So forgiveness, put it always in front of your eyes. Forgive is what you want. What do you forgive from? Do people forgive two things? Mistakes, when someone does a mistake, you forgive him. Or delinquencies, taqseer. When someone doesn't do his duty well, or what is expected from him, it may not be a mistake, but it's a type of a sin. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad that he forgave him his sins. What kind of sins did the Prophet do? Just being unable of thanking Allah for his gifts. This in itself is a sin. Just being unable to thank Allah as he should be thanked. And none of us can. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ said. None of you will be allowed to paradise in return for his work. Not even you, O Prophet of Allah. He said, not even me. Except if Allah showers me with mercy. So as we said, every one of us has three records. The record of hasanat, good deeds. The record of sayyat, bad deeds. But the third one is the main problem. If it's opened, we're finished. And it's the record of gifts. The gifts given to us by Allah. The blessings of Allah. Because none of us can thank Allah properly for it. So to conclude, the Quran, in the eighth and the last session, brothers, all through the workshop, through the eight sessions, we spoke about the Quran as the cure of your spiritual weakness, which is mainly al-ujb, pride. The Quran is the cure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the Quran as a cure. In Surah Yunus, verse number 57, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhan nas, speaking to all people, not to Muslims. When Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, He speaks to us alone. But here this verse talks to all people. Muslims and non-Muslims, Ya ayyuhan nas, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. People, a teaching from your Lord has come to you. Number one, a healing for what is in your hearts. It heals the hearts. It heals the spirits. And guidance and mercy for the believers. So the Quran is the cure. How? Number one, I'm reviewing what we took before with you. The Quran makes us know Allah better, knowing Allah through the Quran. The more we know Allah, the more we feel like we need Allah. The more you know Allah, the more you feel the ubudiyyah and you feel the servitude. And we spoke about very important three names, Al-Qayyum, the ever-watchful, the giver, Al-Mun'im, and the self-sufficient, Al-Ghani. Those three names, if you focus on them and on the verses in the Quran that talk about them, it will help you a lot feel that you need Allah in every breath, every move that you make. Second, the Quran cures our spiritual weaknesses because the Quran introduces us to ourselves. You know your own self. And you know through the Quran that your ego is the most dangerous thing. The most dangerous, the worst of your enemies is your ego, not the shaitan. Your own ego. myself. The self is stingy, rebellious, selfish. And you have to control. You have to control it. The Quran tells us how insignificant our deeds are. No matter how good they are, no matter how many they are, no matter how much, insignificant. By what? By continuously informing us about this, the continuous state of worship of all the creation. As I said last time, imagine that you wake up very early in the morning on Friday and you want to come to the mosque to be the first one. So you come for Jumu'ah at 8 a.m. expecting to be the first one to enter the mosque and come and sit here in the first row and wait and take the thawab and read Al-Kahf. And then when you come to the mosque at 8, you don't find a place to step in. The mosque is packed. How will you feel? That's exactly should be your feeling when you learn, when you're very happy with your acts of worship. And then Allah tells you in the Quran, فَإِنِ اسْتَكْبَرُوا فَالَّذِينَ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ يُسَبِّحُونَ لَهُ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَا يَسْأَمُونَ وَهُمْ لَا يَسْأَمُونَ. Allah says in the Quran, if they are too arrogant, those who are with your Lord glorify Him tirelessly night and day. So don't be so happy with your deeds. May Allah accept them. Allah doesn't need your deeds. You need them. You need to do them in order to receive the mercy of Allah. But Allah doesn't really need it. Everything around you worships and prays and makes tasbih. So it tells you how insignificant your good deeds are, even though you need to do it. But still, the more you do, the more you become subject to receive the mercy of Allah. The Quran, number 4, warns us from arrogance and pride and explain to us and give us a lot of examples. Iblis, his arrogance and his ego destroyed him. Is Iblis an atheist? Iblis is not an atheist. Iblis believes that there is Allah. And he knows that Allah is the creator. And he knows, but his ego. Ana khayru minhu. I am better than him. It's an ego. Who deluded Iblis? Who misguided Iblis? Another Iblis? Worse than Iblis. I. Ana. Fir'aun. Alaysa li mulku Misr. Don't I have the authority on Egypt? Fir'aun. His problem is I. Qarun, same thing. All those kuffar, sahibul jannatain, the owner of the two gardens, which is the second story in Surah Al-Kahf. If you remember when we spoke about Surah Al-Kahf, and by the way, inshallah, we can do a series on Surah Al-Kahf if you want. So sahibul jannatain, what? He thought that he's rich, and this is something personal. He forgot that Allah gave him this. He said, even if there is a day of judgment, I will find the same on the day of judgment because he's rich. He will always be rich. Even on the day of judgment, he expects himself to be rich also there. In Al-Akhirah, he will be rich. Ego can make people crazy. 5. The Quran prescribes the medicine from pride and arrogance by, number 1, reminding you with the ni'am, with the gifts of Allah. And he keeps telling you to try to count his gifts. Try to remember his gifts. Ya bani Israel, adhkuru ni'mati allati an'amtu alaykum wa anni faddaltukum. Oh, sons of Israel, remember my gifts upon you. Remember what I gave you. So the Quran reminds you with the gifts of Allah. At the same time, the Quran reminds you of death. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will have a taste of death. So when you hear this, it wakes you up. It's like a wake-up call. Wake up. You will die one day. It reminds you that there is accountability and that you will stand up before Allah and you will be asked about everything you did. 6. The Quran told us how Allah disciplined the best human beings, the prophets and the messengers. The Quran told us this, and we had a whole lecture about how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was disciplined by the Quran. All of them were disciplined and became the best servants of Allah. They had the feeling of servitude, and it affected them and affected their personalities and affected their humbleness. This is through the Quran. A word from Yusuf made him stay in jail for years. The man going out, he told him, وَقَالَ لِلَّذِي ظَنَّ أَنَّهُ نَاجٍ مِّنْهُمَا اذْكُرْنِي عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ فَأَنْسَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ ذِكْرَ رَبِّهِ فَلَبِثَ فِي السِّجْنِ بِضْعَ سِنِينَ. He told the man, the verse says, Joseph said to the one he knew would be saved, mention me to your master. Tell the king about me. I'm here in jail. And I'm forgotten in jail. So what happened? He stayed in jail several years. Allah disciplined his prophets. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, a night journey from Mecca to Medina on a special ride with Jibreel. Ascendance to the heavens. He reached the Sidratul Muntaha, the low tree that no one can go after it. He reached the maximum. Khalas, he is there. After all this, Allah reminded him that everything is just given to him. Nothing is personal. All his strength, all his success, everything is just given to him. And Allah tells him this verse after coming back from Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. He's a human being. So Allah told him, وَلَئِن شِئْنَا لَنَذْهَبَنَّ بِالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ ثُمَّ لَا تَجِدُ لَكَ عَلَيْنَا وَكِيلًا إِلَّا رَحْمَةً مِّن رَبِّكَ إِنَّ فَضْلَهُ كَانَ عَلَيْكَ كَبِيرًا. If we pleased, we could take away what we have revealed to you, which Allah is telling him, I can take away the Quran from you. Then you would find no one to plead for you against us if it were not for your Lord's mercy. His favor to you has been truly great. The Quran tells us that everything that we are enjoying is not personal. It's from Allah. If you're smart, if you're intelligent, if you're beautiful, if you're strong, if you're healthy, if you're wealthy, it's all from Allah. Nothing from you personally. It all comes from Allah. See, subhanAllah, يعني, even the Prophet's steadfastness and perseverance comes from Allah. Allah tells him in Surah Al-Isra, وَلَوْلَا أَن ثَبَّتْنَاكَ لَقَدْ كِتَّ تَرْكَنُ إِلَيْهِمْ شَيْئًا قَلِيلًا. If we have not made you stand firm, you would almost have inclined a little towards them. Even the Prophet's perseverance and steadfastness comes from Allah. Not personal. Warning the Prophet himself from shirk. Can you imagine this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him in Surah Al-Isra, verse 22, لَا تَجْعَلْ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهًا آخَرَ فَتَقْعُدَ مَذْمُومًا مَخْذُولًا. Set up not other gods beside God, or you will end up disgraced and forsaken. Can anyone expect Prophet Muhammad to take another god with Allah? Never. But he doesn't mean to take an idol. It means to believe in anyone, that anyone can help you except Allah. That's why when people ask me, who are the most free people in the world? I'll tell you, the most free people in the world are the Palestinians in Gaza. I see them as the only free people, by the way. They are not occupied, physically occupied. Yes, they have tanks in the streets, and this is physically. But mentally and spiritually, they are free. Why? Because they do not believe except in Allah. They don't believe that the UN can help. They don't believe that the Arabs will help. They don't believe that America will help. So they are free. Others are occupied, even though they may not be physically occupied. But spiritually and mentally occupied. So I believe when Allah talks to Prophet Muhammad, telling him, do not take other gods with God, I believe the Quran here means spiritually and mentally. I told you Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was on his right, on his camel, and then his whip, small whip that they used to direct the camel, it fell on the ground, so he had to go all the way down and then to take his whip. And his assistant was walking next to the camel. He said, why did you do this? Why didn't you tell me to give you the whip? Why did you come down the camel, and then it took you like minutes to let the camel go down and ride the camel again and take the camel up? Why? You told him, let me tell you something. It's a secret. Me and 50 other companions gave the pledge to Prophet Muhammad, أَلَّا نَسْأَلَ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا, that we never ask people for anything. Just depend on ourselves. We depend on Allah. We rely on Allah. We don't ask any favor from anyone. Subhanallah. Those were the students of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because this is how Allah disciplined him too. The Sahaba, after every victory, they are reminded by the Quran that they did nothing. It's all from Allah. Subhanallah. فَلَمْ تَقْتُلُوهُمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ قَتَلَهُمْ وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. Allah tells them, you did not kill them, Allah killed them, your enemies. You did not throw, Allah threw. We just do things to go to paradise, inshallah. But everything, all the works come from Allah. After Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَدَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِغَيْظِهِمْ لَمْ يَنَالُوا خَيْرًا وَكَفَى اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْقِتَالِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ قَوِيًا عَزِيزًا. Everything is done by Allah here. The verse says in Surah Al-Ahzab, God sent back the disbelievers along with their rage. They gained no benefit, and Allah spared the believers from fighting. He is strong and mighty. It's all about the strength of Allah and the might of Allah. After Bani Nadir, the Jews of the tribe of Bani Nadir, who tried to assassinate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were expelled out from Medina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِي أَخْرَجَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ لِأَوَّلِ الْحَشْرِ ما ظننتم أن يخرجوا وظنوا أنهم مانعتهم حصونهم من الله فأتاهم الله من حيث لم يحتسبوا من احتسبوا وقذف في قلوبهم الرعب. It was he, Allah, who drove those of the people of the book who broke faith out from their homes at the first gathering of forces. You believers never thought they would go, and they themselves thought their fortifications would protect them from God. God came up on them from where they least expected and put panic into their hearts. So it's all about Allah. Actually, the believers attacked them and made them scared. Allah says, it's Allah who came on them, and it's Allah who threw panic in their hearts. You are nothing without Allah. On the other side, subhanallah, the Quran gives you a lot of self-confidence. After all this, telling you that I do nothing and Allah does everything, then I will feel, I won't have any confidence. No, actually, when the Quran tells you that your strength comes from Allah, your success comes from Allah, then your strength is the best. Is the best level of, because it's not your strength, it comes from Allah. So it will give you self-confidence that what you do, if you are backed up by Allah, you will do the best. When Allah tells you that He has chosen you to be the Khalifa, Allah tells you, I have chosen you to be my trustee on earth. This gives you self-confidence. Then you are the best of creation. When Allah tells you, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ, just human beings are honored for being human beings. This gives human beings self-confidence. A good self-image. The best of creation. Honored above all the creation. When Allah keeps telling you, if you think, if you utilize your intellect, those people of understanding, you find a lot of verses ending like that. Ulil albab, qawmun yadhakkarun, qawmun yatafakkarun. Allah speaks about utilizing your intellect. If human beings are stupid creatures, then Allah won't tell them to use their intellect. But Allah tells you, you are intellectual. But your intellect is given to you by Allah. So you have the best intellect. So when Allah tells you all your success and all your strength comes from Allah, it's giving you self-confidence. But you should always thank Allah. 8. The Quran reminds all the time with Allah's might and Allah's strength and might. And with the continuously mentioning of Allah's might, this makes it engraved in your subconscious. So it will be reflected on your beliefs and on your behavior. So you always mention Allah all the time. You say, we will do this by the grace of Allah. I got a job by the grace of Allah. I was given a child by the grace of Allah. So you always mention Allah because you know that Allah does everything. So this will be embedded. The Quran increases your iman. Some people memorize the whole Quran and they do terrible stuff, terrible things. They may even support the Israelis. Yeah, I know people. I know that. I know people who memorize the whole Quran and they go against the people of Gaza. Why? They just, in Egypt we say, Hafiz mish fahim. They just memorize. They don't reflect upon it. So the Quran did not change them. So number one, you need to keep yourself busy with the Quran. You want to benefit from the Quran? Give it yourself. Let me tell you a small story. I know someone who wanted to learn the tilawa and the recitation. And he is someone who likes to excel. So he went to the best reciters in Egypt and they taught him. And then he came to a level that he cannot do better than this. He's unable to do better than this. But he did not excel yet. And he was troubled by that. He kept going to the very famous reciters, like Muhammad Jibreel and others. And they told him, brother, khalas, you're not actually improving. You're okay, like 80%. He says, no, I want to be 100%. But it's not working. You've been doing a lot, you're coming a lot, taking a lot of lessons, and you're not improving. So he was advised to go to a sheikh who is not famous. He sits in a very small mosque somewhere in Cairo. And he went to him and he told him, I want to learn, I want to excel, and I can't improve more than 80%. What can I do? And is there no way that I can excel and be like 100% in the recitation? He said, no, of course you can. He said, why am I not improving? The sheikh said, I don't know. Tell me, what do you do every day? He said, I wake up for Fajr and I go to work and I come back and I eat and I go out with my friends. And every time I have spare time, I give it to the Quran. So the Sheikh said, this is the problem. You're giving the Quran your spare time. That's not enough. You give the Quran its time and then put everything else around it. The time you give to the Quran is for the Quran. Like that, Allah will bless this time. So the brother gave the Quran between Maghrib and Isha every Friday only. He goes every Friday to this Sheikh to teach him recitation between Maghrib and Isha. Six times, he was perfect. And then he went to another Sheikh and he read the whole Quran with him and he got the ijazah. Why? Because you don't give the Quran your spare time. As we said, we need to reflect upon the Quran for about 60 minutes every day. It cures. In the language you understand. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Fear Allah, Allah will teach you. Some people are proud of their teachers. He says, I learned under Sheikh Bin Baz. I learned under Sheikh Qaradawi. So those are our teachers. So people become very proud. The more the teacher is a better teacher, the more people are proud of the teacher. What if your teacher is Allah? Allah said so. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. If you fear Allah, Allah will teach you. Your teacher will become Allah. He will inspire you, Allah. Just fear Allah. When you read the Quran, choose the place, choose the time, choose the atmosphere. So don't go where it's, if you get distracted easily, then don't go to a place where there's a lot of distractions. And you need to read slowly. You need to reflect upon the meanings. Take time. Take your time. This is all, of course, in the Tarbiya Imaniya workshop that we took before, but I'm just revising this with you. Concentrate. Think why Allah mentioned this and mentioned that. Interact with the verses of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Furqan, in Surah Al-Furqan, the last 10 verses of Surah Al-Furqan, they mention 12 attributes of people who are called Ibad al-Rahman. Ibad al-Rahman, the servants of al-Rahman, or the worshippers of al-Rahman, who will be qualified on the Day of Judgment to receive the Rahmah from Allah. Among those 12 attributes is وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا صُمًّا وَعُمْيَانًا. When they are reminded with their Lord's verses, they do not turn a deaf ear or a blind eye to them, which means when they read, they interact with it. When you read the Quran and you see Allah talking about the good people and righteous people who will be entering paradise, you stop here and you make dua. Oh Allah, make me among them. Oh Allah, I want to be among those righteous people. And then when you read about evil people who will be thrown in hell, stop and make dua. Oh Allah, make me away from them. Make me not among those people. Save me from hellfire. So you interact with the Quran. لَمْ يَخِرُّ عَلَيْهَا صُمًّا وَعُمْيَانًا. There are people who just read without understanding. And they listen to the reciters. So the reciter is reciting an ayah that talks about hellfire and punishment in hellfire, but his voice is very beautiful, and people say, mashallah, again, say it again. Guys, you don't even understand what he's saying. The ayah should scare you, and you are enjoying the, because people became now like just enjoying the tunes. Tunes. Some people don't call it Quran anymore.
You're on the in the car with a friend and he asks me, would you like to listen to Mashari?
Who?
Mashari? What's Mashari? Quran. Okay, say Quran. Okay, would you like Abu Bakr al-Shatiri? Or Mashari? Or Abd al-Basit? So that's how it is now. Okay, if I choose one of them, okay, we just put it. He didn't even ask me for which surah. Not important. Because they just listen to tunes. This is a crisis. We have a crisis. The way we deal with the Quran. And the Quran makes you, as I said, know who Allah is, reminds you of death, reminds you to keep spending. So all this is very important. But the problem is, still, we have ego and people praise us. And you may be promoted tomorrow or become the head of an organization and people will praise you, look at you highly, and you start feeling pride. What? We cannot avoid this. And don't avoid it. If you're promoted, if you become the head of an organization like IFE, UKIM, MAB, these Islamic organizations is good, but the problem is, be careful from your ego. What do you do to yourself when someone praises you in public? Or when you're promoted, or when you feel that pride is entering into your heart, you give yourself a shot. What is this shot? It's a shot that you need to give yourself quickly. When people have diabetes and they feel like they have a problem with their sugar level in their blood, they give themselves a shot. You have a shot to give to yourself, which is criticize yourself in public. When people start say, hey, mashallah, you're so knowledgeable, we want to learn from you. Say, you brothers don't know. Allah, there are things that if you know, you won't even look in my eyes. You won't even shake my hands. People go like, what? Does this man go to drink every night or something? So you just criticize yourself. Yeah, people look at you highly because you became the head of an organization. You can mention, say, I have a lot of shortcomings. The problem is, some people say so to look humble. Be careful of this, because this is called faked humbleness, which is more strong. But you can mention that. One of my shortcomings is that I haste. I sometimes take decisions without consultation. You know what? Ask advice from people. This really destroys the ego. But the problem is, when you tell people, can you advise me? So that he tells you, advise you about what? MashaAllah, you're perfect. So don't do that. Go to your colleagues tomorrow, give them papers and say, don't write your names on it. I want you to write an advice for me. A shortcoming. What would you like me to change in myself? And don't write your names. They will really write things for you. This is a shot that you give to yourself. Or humble yourself. Humble yourself. Do something humble. Take out the garbage. Some of us do that here, actually, of course. But the issue is, some of us also come from cultures that, hey, come on, the wife should do that, should do the cleaning of the house. No, you go and clean your house. The Prophet ﷺ used to clean his house, mend his shoes, mend his clothes. When a button is cut, what do? You throw your shirt to your wife and you tell her, put another button. No, you do it for yourself. What's wrong with you? Take the garbage out. Clean your brother's shoes. What's wrong with that? You remember who did this homework? You remember the homework? Very hard, huh? You remember it, huh? It was washing the shoes of your brother. Not the shoes. Washing the feet of your brothers. Did anyone here did that? Why not? You know that Jesus did that? He washed the feet of his disciples. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. He spoke harshly to Bilal.
And the Prophet ﷺ told him, Ya Aba Dharr, innahu baqiya fi qalbika min kibri al-jahiliyyati shay'. O Abu Dharr, there is still some pride of the pre-Islamic time, the era of jahiliyyah. There is still some pride of the jahiliyyah in your heart. What did Abu Dharr do? He put his cheek on the ground and he said, Wallahi, I am not going to lift my face from the ground until Bilal steps up on the other cheek with his shoes. Because what happened is, he told him, Ya Ibn al-Sawda, you are the son of the black woman. It is not an option. If you are a Muslim, you cannot be a racist. And in our community, we have a lot of racists. Many of us are racists. No, she cannot marry a Pakistani. Why? Because she is from Bangladesh. Wallahi, I don't even know the difference between Bangladesh and Pakistan as an Arab, yeah. Why? What's the difference? Subhanallah. No, she cannot marry. Khalas. Let her be unmarried for the... What's wrong with you? And this man who says so, he goes to the mosque every day. What are you doing in the mosque? You're racist. Subhanallah. The original sin. According to Christianity, it's what? Adam ate from the forbidden tree. According to Islam, the original sin, the first sin, is not the sin of Adam, it's the sin of Satan, Iblis, who refused to bow down for Adam. And Allah blamed him in the Quran. Why didn't you prostrate yourself to the one that I created with my hands? He said, because I am better than him. You created me from fire and you created him from clay. I am white and he's black. Or I am black, or I am Arab and he is Indian. Or I am Bengali and he is Pakistani. The original sin in Islam is not an orange or not an apple that was eaten from a tree. It's racism. God said, get out from paradise. You cannot act as a racist here. You cannot act arrogantly here. He wasn't arrogant because he's rich. He was arrogant because of his race. So this means that racism is not an option. You cannot be racist and Muslim, and racists have no place in paradise. How can people be Muslim and racists? This is important to understand. You really need to thank your enemies, your foes. Thank your foes because they call you bad things. But at the same time, this balances with those who praise you. Because those who praise you, they inflate in your ego. Those who attack you, they destroy your ego. So actually, I wish that every one of us goes to his foes and thank them. Thank you, foes, for doing the balance in my life. Telling me about how bad am I. Because some of them, they say, you're stingy. Don't be angry. Maybe you're really stingy. You're a coward. Don't be angry. Maybe you're really a coward. Try to find your shortcomings. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-mu'min mir'atu akhi. A mu'min, a believer, is a mirror for his fellow believer. What do we see in our mirrors? Not ourselves. Our shortcomings. Those who want to see themselves, just look in a picture. You'll see yourself. And you went with a tie and a suit to take a picture, so you look at something beautiful, inshallah. But if you want to see your shortcomings, look in the mirror. We look in the mirror every day, and we start fixing the shortcomings. Until the shortcomings that can be fixed are fixed, we go. So when the Prophet says, a believer is a mirror for his fellow believer, it means that a believer should show this fellow believer his shortcomings. By what? By giving nasiha, advising. So you should seek this knowledge, this information. What are my shortcomings? What should I enhance? What should I nourish in myself? What should I prevent? This is something important.
And this will not happen if you keep listening to people who praise you. Those who praise you, they are destroying you. And the Prophet said, Al-Madhu huwa al-dhabh. Or he said something like that. That praising is like slaying someone. Because I remember the hadith is that someone praised someone else and the Prophet said, لَقَدْ قَطَعْتَ عُنُقَ أَخِيكَ. You cut his throat. لَوْ سَمِعَكَ مَا أَفْلَحَ. Had he listened to you, he would never be successful. Which means that he wasn't even there. Don't praise. Encourage. Encourage people, but don't really praise. Praise can destroy. Anyway, again, we're خلاص ending this workshop. In this workshop, we saw that pride is your biggest enemy. Your ego is your biggest enemy. We do a lot of good deeds, but many of us don't do it with sincerity. So your homework for the end of your life is to be sincere. How can you do so? Do secret deeds between you and Allah. Try when you give in charity not to be in public. Of course, when you're in a fundraiser, people who will fundraise today for Gaza, they will hate that I say so. But of course, try also to give in public and secretly. Because in public, sometimes you encourage people, but at the same time, do other things secretly. You need to do secret things. The nawafil, all the extra prayers should be done at home. Should be done secretly. If you are here between two prayers and you cannot do it at home, okay. But the issue is, if you're coming from home, pray at home, your nafila, your extra, your sunnah before you come here. But people enjoy praying sunnah here, even if they are going home. And the Prophet warned from this. He said, don't make your houses like tombs. Your houses are not graves. We don't just go to die there every night or to sleep there every night. We go there to pray too. So all these good deeds, when it's done secretly, the shaitan comes and tells you, tell them, explain to them, tell them, inform your friends that you are good. And Allah wants your sincerity. You do it for the sake of Allah, not for the sake of anyone else, or not to be praised. So do a lot of extra good work, like sawm, fasting, like prayers, extra prayers, like praying at night, without informing people. Have your secret life with Allah. You will enjoy it so much if you have a secret life with Allah. Jazakumullahu khairan. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah accept from you. And may Allah accept this effort that you came here 8 times and listened. And those who did their homework. And may Allah grant us sincerity and humbleness. I hope to see you again, inshallah, in the future. With a series on Surah Al-Kahf, bi-iznillah.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. And also may Allah bless you for beautiful delivery of the presentation over the